Yes, those of you that that are not here for the first time, but you have been here before, welcome back to the house today. So forgive me for not welcoming you back as well. You know, we live in a time where so many people are asleep as to the things of God and what we should be doing. You know, when you go to the other side of life, what I mean by this is that the Bible says that it is appointed unto every person once to die. Whether we pass on before Jesus returns or we see him and we meet him in the air, whatever the case is, whenever we transition to that other side of life, everybody knows then that they should have been in church. Everybody knows then that Jesus is the Savior, the way, the truth, and the life. Everybody knows then that they should have given their life to the Lord and lived their life unto him and for him. But for some, unfortunately, it's too late then. And so we live in a time where, you know, and this, I say this because it's good to see you in the house today. You know, so many people are very casual about their walk with God, very casual about Christianity. You know, if I feel tired, I don't go to church. I'll just, I may watch it on a live stream somewhere. But it's so good to be in the house of the Lord, in the place of where other believers are gathered together in the name of the Lord. And the Bible says in the book of Hebrews that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, because some do, as it says. But let it not be said of you or me that we forsake. But every time the doors of the church are open, we should be there. We should be there to hear what God is saying, to support what is going on, and to encourage one another as we all are walking in these last of the last days. So God bless you for being here today. Thank you for whoever it was invited you. I believe it was Brittany. All right. So thank you, Brittany, for inviting them. All right. So God bless you. And we pray that you have enjoyed yourselves thus far and that you will continue to be impacted by everything that is said and done here today. Amen. Amen. All righty. Well, let's pray as we get ready to get into God's word for today. I think I'll just hold on to this mic, sir. Thank you. Let's pray. Father, we come before you today in the name of Jesus, and we bless you. We thank you for this time of gathering together in your name that you've given us. Such a great opportunity, Father, to continue to grow in understanding of your word. For it is your word that provides the truth that we need to hear, to change our lives and the circumstances of our lives, that we may walk in your freedom. As your word says, we shall know the truth, and that truth that we know shall make us free. We thank you, Father, for that. For it's your word that keeps us clean from all of the contaminants of the world. We thank you, Father, for it is through your word that our minds are renewed, that we may walk according to your purposes and your counsel, according to your wisdom. Thank you for this time of Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year. You've brought us to the start of another year, Father, your calendar year. And we thank you for the outlook, the blessings, the things that you've prepared for us in this time and in this season. We open our hearts before you as all the books are open right now. That what is in there, Father, that we will continue to evaluate. That as our hearts are presented unto you, that if we find anything that is not like you there, that you'll open our eyes to see. That ultimately, when we stand before you face to face one day, we will hear you say, "Well done, good and faithful." So we thank you today. Our hearts are prepared, our minds are alert and attentive. We receive your word right now because it is life to us. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, you all may take your seats. Well, for those of you that are not as familiar with the importance of God's high holy days, we're going to talk a little bit about this. For those of you that are here for the first time, and maybe this is the first time you're hearing this, or those of you that are watching us, wherever it is that you're watching us from, we want to make sure that you have a clear understanding from the Word of God on why we say some of the things that we say and do some of the things that we do, and some of the things that you've heard us already express today. Last Wednesday night, Pastor John began to share the lead up unto Rosh Hashanah and began to express the importance of this and the benefits that come from this. And then on Friday, began to talk about the King and celebrating the King and acclaiming him and all of the things that that come along with the coronation and the crowning of Jesus as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so then yesterday we had a brunch here and some of you came out, and you know, this is a time of where we celebrate the sweetness and the goodness of God, and all of the things that he has done for us in our lives and what we're expecting him to even do in this year. And so if you heard us say, you know, this is Rosh Hashanah, head of the year, well, there are two calendars that are in place. One, of course, is the Gregorian calendar that our, for the most part, our world system operates according to from January to December. January, according to that calendar, is the beginning of the year. Well, God's civil year begins what we call Rosh Hashanah. And so just for a little scriptural background in regards to this, Leviticus chapter 23, as you've heard it mentioned last week and you've heard us mention in times past, and I'll scroll through this briefly just to continue to lay the background for anybody that is here for the first time. Excuse me, Pastor John. I'm used to the lapel, so I have to be mindful to keep the mic to my mouth. So in Leviticus chapter 23, I'm going to skip through a couple of verses for the sake of time, verse 2 and verse 4. It says, speak unto the children of Israel, and of course this is speaking directly to natural Israel during this time. And of course, we are nowadays, we are what's called spiritual Israel, okay, as we have been grafted in. Speak unto the children of Israel and say unto them concerning the feasts of the Lord. Some have pegged it, as you've heard us say, as the feast of the Jews. But as you clearly see here, according to scripture, this is the feast of the Lord, okay? So these feasts didn't belong to the Jews. He instituted it or made it something that began and instructed them about it, but it was the feast of the Lord. It says, concerning the feast of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations, even these are my feasts. So this is the Lord talking to Moses, telling Moses to tell the children of Israel, these are my feasts, okay? These are my appointed times. These are my established seasons, and I want you to understand these things so that you can walk in them and respect them. You are familiar with the Ten Commandments where it says, one of the commandments says, remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. Well, the Sabbath is not just the seventh day. It is not just the one day a week where we come to church. Sabbaths are also those appointed times. Those are, you have the little Sabbaths and you have the big Sabbaths, okay? So the Sabbath is also those high holy days that God is saying that we need to honor, what we call the feast days, okay? So then in verse 4, it says, these are the feasts of who? The Jews. Who? Okay, I just wanted to make sure your Bible says the same thing that mine does. All right, so these are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocations, which you shall proclaim in their seasons. Not your season, okay? Not your season, not when it's convenient for you, okay? In their seasons, all right? How many of you are married? Okay, you have a wedding date we call a what? Anniversary. Have you ever missed that anniversary? You better not. Guess what happens if you miss that anniversary? You might miss out on a whole lot of other benefits. You know what I'm saying? All right? So it is important to understand that there are appointed times that God has established. And we must meet God at those times that he said that we should meet him. And so let's turn to, let's see, Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1. So technically, Rosh Hashanah celebrates the civil year, or when God created the heavens and the earth. So when we read in Genesis chapter 1, we can start in verse 1. It says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Okay? This is what is what Rosh Hashanah celebrates. Okay? The beginning of when God created heaven and earth. This is what Rosh Hashanah is all about, Genesis 1:1. And then we see here, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Verse 3, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And of course, this light was not the sun and not the moon, okay? But the light is his son, all right? And it says, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning was the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. Then it goes on down, just for the sake of time, let's go down to verse, let's see. Let me find it. All right, verse 14, it says, and God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and seasons, or moedim, and for days and for years. So the seasons that he was referencing here were the appointed times. So God already had his timetable and his seasons, his times already scheduled, his appointed time scheduled. And so he gave us the sun, he gave us the moon, and he gave us the stars so that we would understand the timings of his appointed times. They were like road signs on 95 so that you could understand where you are in your destination, so you can know when you arrive, how far away you are from it, and so you can understand what God is saying right here, okay? So he gave us the sun, the moon, and the stars so that we could understand his seasons, okay? And so Rosh Hashanah celebrates this time of the year of when God, this is God's fall feast, the beginning of God's fall feast, of where we celebrate the beginning or the head of the year, okay? So Pastor John already mentioned some of the things in regards to the head of the year. Here are some things that Rosh Hashanah represents. It represents a realignment and reminder that I am the head and not the tail. You understand that? Okay? So you can go back to even the blessings that were mentioned in Deuteronomy chapter 28, okay, where it says all these blessings will overtake you if you hearken to the voice of the Lord your God, okay, to obey his word, you know, do those things that he said that we should do. And so so it's a realignment. You know, you look back over the things that have taken place this past year, since the last Rosh Hashanah, okay? Some good, some bad, and some ugly things, okay? But this is a time now of realignment, or to recalibrate your life, okay? This is a time where the things from the past season, God gives us an opportunity to have a do-over. You understand? To start fresh. And so this is what this time represents, a time of creation, all right? And so it's ahead of the year. There's a refreshing that takes place during this time. There's a resetting that God begins to do in our lives during this time, okay? So even last Sunday, you heard the word of the Lord that came through Apostle Rock and basically expressing a year of excitement, okay? There will be some astonishing things that will take place this year. It's just like when Jesus stood up in the synagogue in Luke chapter 4, and he found where it was written about him in Isaiah, and he stood up and he read it, and he said, "This day, this scripture is fulfilled in your ears." And so Jesus spoke and he proclaimed, and then, of course, you know, he did this in Nazareth. And how many of you know sometimes people that know you or have such a common place with you, they sometimes can miss the anointing or the gift of God that is on your life, okay? They can not necessarily intentionally, okay, but it still happens where they don't value the calling of God on your life because they've always known you, you know, in their mind, okay? And so Jesus stood up and he declared and decreed these things in Nazareth, and you know they wanted to throw him off a cliff, and the Bible says that he turned and he walked right through the midst of them. All right, and so then it goes on and it talks about how he went throughout Galilee preaching and so forth and all of these things. You know, he continued to do that. But so he stood up and he declared the acceptable year of the Lord, or the year of Jubilee. That's what he declared during that time. And their hearts did not receive what he said. And so it's important to recognize and understand, even in the days that we live in, Jesus still speaks. Okay, sometimes he speaks to us directly. Other times he speaks through a prophet or apostle, pastor, teacher, or a psalmist, or someone that God uses and he works through. Sometimes he speaks to us through other means, okay? But the important thing is that we recognize when the Lord is speaking to us. Whatever the means is that he is communicating to us, it's important to understand and to have a heart that recognizes when the Lord is speaking to you. Okay, if your heart is hard or your neck is stiff, as the Bible says, then you won't receive what God is saying to you. You'll be just like those ones in Nazareth that are looking to throw Jesus off the cliff. All right. And so it's so important to understand and have hearts, okay, that are, as a song that we just sang, that are bowed down to, that are soft and pliable to receive what God is saying. And when you hear it, you say, "Lord, that's me. That's for me." And whether I'm in the right or in the wrong, or this is something that I need to change or grow in, I recognize it and I receive it, because this is a time, again, Rosh Hashanah. One of the things is that all the books are open. What books are open? Well, there are books that are written about us every day and all of the occurrences in our lives. How many of you are familiar with the book of Acts? Yes, you know, okay. It's a book after John in the New Testament, okay, the Acts of the Apostles. Well, the book of Acts was written about the Acts, the things that they did, that the apostles did. And so every day there are different things that are written about us. How many of you know, okay, whether you knew this or not, there are angels that are scribing, writing right now, everything about each person that is in here, okay? So what are they writing down? They're writing down your thoughts. They're writing down the attitudes of your heart. They're writing down your actions. And they're writing down your words, okay? Those four things, at least, they're writing down, okay? How do we know that these things are being written down? Well, one, in the book of Malachi, it talks about the book of remembrance, about when we, and that's another book, okay, when we got together and we talked about the Lord and so forth. The Jesus mentioned this. He mentioned that, and I use this as a reference just to show that, okay, well, let's look at this one. In Hebrews chapter 4, I think it is, it talks about how the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing to the asunder of the spirit, the joints, the marrow, and the heart. And it says that it is even a discerner of the thoughts and the intent of the heart. Okay? So there's not anything in the deepest, innermost part of us that is not open and revealed unto the Lord. So there are angels that are writing down on the behalf of the Lord, okay, everything about our lives. We are being documented every day, okay? All right? So we may not be in the book of Acts that we read in the Bible, but guess what? There are things that are written about us, okay? So it's not, look at the person beside you. I don't want you to get all feel bad now, because some of you are starting to feel bad because you know what you're thinking, all right? But listen, it's not all bad stuff that's written, okay? Look at the person beside you and say, "Shoo!" All right. So the good things that you have done are also being written down. All right. So everything, okay, not just the things that, you know, other people didn't know that you did, that, you know, the Lord knows, and you're like, "Thank God nobody else knew." All right. Forgive me, Lord. All right. But everything about our lives are written down. During Rosh Hashanah, the Bible says that all the books are open. Okay? In Revelation chapter 20, verse 12, it talks about the great white throne judgment. And in this, it says, you know, the sea, hell, the grave, everything gave up all the dead that were in them. Okay? And this is not talking about believers. This is talking about those that were not, that did not accept Jesus, that did not live for Jesus. Okay? This is what the great white throne judgment is all about, okay? So there's the resurrection unto life, and then there's a resurrection unto death. This is the resurrection unto death. And so the great white throne judgment talks about how the books are all open. This is Rosh Hashanah. This is that time. So we see throughout the Bible in different accounts, okay, from Genesis to Revelation, we see the Moedim, the appointed times, that are all throughout the scriptures, okay? And when you look throughout the book of Revelation, specifically, all of the trumpets that are blasted and all of the different things that are going on, these all occur during these appointed times, okay? So God doesn't just do things randomly, okay? We do sometimes, you know? But God does not just randomly do things. He has appointed times and he has purposes. And this is why he's telling us to understand these things so that we can align ourselves with his timings, with his purposes. Because during these timings and purposes, there are things that are open during these times that aren't open during other times. So the Bible says in Revelation 20:12 that all the books were open and they were judged out of those books, okay, for all of the things that they did. And the reason that they were mainly judged out of all of those books was because their name was not written in the Lamb's book of life. And so because their name was not there, it had been blotted out there, guess what? They were judged based on everything, good, bad, and ugly, that they had done. Okay? Because nothing, I don't care if everything that was written about them was good, there's no work that can save a person. There's only the blood of Jesus. That's the only name that salvation comes through. So no matter what was written in their books, it did not provide salvation. And so this is speaking of that time, okay? So just as an example. Now, as you heard last week, time of excitement. And I want you to understand this. When God speaks something, he's talking to the church in this, okay? He's not talking to the world when he said this is a time of excitement. Do you guys understand this? Okay? There are always two worlds that are going on, okay? But they're parallel with each other. Jesus said in John 16:33, he says, "Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world, conquered it for you." In the world, you're going to have tribulation. So what is he saying here? In the world, there is trouble. There's problems, there's drama, you know, there's all of these things. He says, all of this is going on, but he says, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. So while all of the drama, the trauma, the trouble, and the tribulation is going on in the world, you will hear them talk about it. You will hear many news feeds about it. All of this is going on. But he says to you, be of good cheer, for I have overcome it and conquered it for you. So while this is going on, I want you to understand that it doesn't have to be that way for you, okay? So we have an example of that in the Bible back in Genesis, where it mentions the land of Goshen. I want to turn there real quick just so you can see this and you can understand how there's always a parallel of while things are going very bad in the world. And Jesus told us, you know, the world is coming to an end, not us. Okay, you understand this, okay? These things have to happen to get to a certain place, but understand that God has keeping power for all of us during those times. And so in Genesis chapter 45, this is where Goshen is first mentioned. And there's some things that the Lord showed me out of this. I'm pulling out. And there's a principle in the Bible called the law of first mention. When something is first mentioned in the Bible, that there's something there that that God is showing us as something established, okay? Just like it says, I forget the scripture where it's exactly found, but it says, it talks about in the 13th year, it talks about rebellion. And normally what happens when your child turns, you know, 13, they become a teenager. So 13 sometimes represents a number of rebellion. Not always, but you know that there is a change that normally takes place when a child gets to a certain age. Just as an example, that's the first time it was mentioned in the Bible, was 13, and you know, so those type of references is what I'm referring to. But in Genesis chapter 45, this is during the account, an apostle's been teaching on Joseph on Wednesday nights for a few weeks. I've been talking about Joseph and Benjamin and all of that. And so this account in Genesis 45 talks about when Joseph sins for his father. And we can pick up in the, let's just pick up in verse 9. It says, haste ye and go up to my father and say unto him, thus says thy son Joseph, God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down unto me and tarry not. And then we pick up some things here that go on with the land of Goshen. So one thing you have to understand here, this is when the children of Israel first begin to come into the land of Goshen. We see during the plagues in Egypt, during that time, which happens much later, okay, 400 years later, up to 400 years later. But this happened way down the road, where we see that while there was turmoil that was going on in Egypt, there was none of this going on in the land of Goshen, okay? And so we see here, here's one of the first things that we see here, and we have to understand, in order to walk in a time of excitement, in order to walk in the peace that Jesus said that we have in a world that is full of tribulation, we have to understand this. Here's the first thing, and thou shalt dwell in the land of Goshen, and here's the first principle, thou shalt be near unto me. So the land of Goshen represents a place of where we are drawn close to the Lord. Not outside, somewhere far away. Not somewhere on the outskirts of God's grace or of his will and purpose. But we see here, thou shalt be near unto me, close to me. God is saying, if you want to be in a place of where you are away from, even though you're in the midst of, the tribulation that is in the world. Come near unto me. And then he says, not just you, but your children and your children's children. So we see here the emphasis that is placed on generational following after the things of God. How many of you know that the enemy is after your children? Okay? Those of you that have grown up in church, you're adults and you're seasoned, what we call seasoned veterans right now, okay? We see and we hear about so many things that go on in the world and how, and just the overall moral values that are in children nowadays that was not present or that is lacking, and that, you know, when we grew up, some of us grew up, you know, we wouldn't dare say or do or act out in some of the things that we see going on. And so God placed, and he's always placed such a strong emphasis on the next generation. He is a generational God, and it's important that not only our children, but our children's children grow up and understand. And this is one of the things that Rosh Hashanah is celebrates, is our time with our families and making sure they understand, okay, who God is and that, and what God has done and where we are and what the importance of all of this is, so that our children will carry on in the legacy, the godly legacy that God established way back when. The Apostle Paul told Timothy, he says, it was in your grandmother, it was in your mother, and I'm persuaded it's in you also. You know, so, you know, something else is there that, you know, didn't come from them. We sometimes see some things in our children, we're like, okay, well, Lord, where in the world did this come from? My Lord. But he says, I'm persuaded that that heritage, that lineage of faith is in you also. Stir it up. Stir up what's in you. And this is what Rosh Hashanah is. It's a time to stir up, okay? Realign ourselves. And so then he says here in verse 11, it says, and there will I nourish you. We see here, there is a place where God has provided, one, being drawn into himself, making sure that not just us, but our children, and there is a place called there that God has nourishment, has provision, has everything that we need. And guess what? It's right in the presence of our enemies. It's right in a land that is full of tribulation and turmoil and trials and testings and problems. Okay? So we have to understand this. And so, look at the person beside you and say, there's a place called there. And that place is important. We have to make sure, again, we're talking about being at a place that is not just anywhere where we want to be. We cannot be outside. Let's just look at this. Those of you Bible scholars that remember what took place with the 10 plagues that came on Egypt. What was to happen if they were outside of the land of Goshen? All of the things that the Egyptians went through, they would have went through. If they stepped out of their house when the destroyer came, guess what would have happened? If they did not put the blood over their doors, what would have happened? So there is a specific place, there is a specific time that God has for all of us. We have to understand the importance of making sure we are aligned properly with that place and with that time so that we can be inside God's protection and inside his provision, right? So I'm saying this because as we see around us in the world that we live in, there are a lot of things that are failing. There are a lot of things that people put their trust in. There are a lot of things that they look to as their source that they see is crumbling. And so we have to understand as a church that these things take place in the world because everything that can be shaken is being shaken, so that people can see that what remains is God's kingdom. And so we have to understand that as we walk in this new year that God has for us of excitement, we have to understand that there is a spiritual Goshen that God has for all of us, a place called there that he has protection, provision, deliverance, healing, okay? All of the things that we need while we're here and we are near the things that go on around us in the world, we see them. The Bible says, with our eyes we behold and we see these things that go on, but it says that it shall not come near our dwelling. And this is what you have to understand, okay? So, these are not as good times in the world, but these are great times in the church, okay? For those, and let me say the church, I'm talking about those that are obeying God's word, okay? All right. So, during Rosh Hashanah, this is called the Feast of Trumpets. And this blast, it does several things. One, Rosh Hashanah is also a day of judgment. As you heard me mention, books are open. There are gates that are open right now, okay? That during this fall feast time, there are gates that are open, all right? And all throughout scriptures, you see examples of these times where these gates were open. The awakening blast is for the dead to provide, for the dead is to provide spiritual awakening. As the Bible says, at the trump of God, the dead in Christ shall arise first, okay? That's, okay, another clue, all right, that we see in the scriptures in the New Testament. But the sounding of the shofar, the trump of God, is for an awakening of those things that were dead in us, okay? And this is why I say this is a time of awakening, of recalibration, realigning ourselves, because some things we got away from. Some things we got soft on. Some things we got, you know, lackadaisical about. We got, you know, very complacent about, okay? So this trumpet is like to jar you, to get you to wake up and reposition yourself with the purposes of God. And this is what this blast of the trumpet does, okay? It begins to break down walls in our souls. You heard Apostle talking about the mind, the will, and emotions, and those things that begin to prevent us from obeying God's word and you know from accepting the seed of God's word when it's sown in our hearts, okay? This begins to tear down the walls just like when they marched around Jericho. And they blast that trumpet, and they shout it. And you know, our voice is the shofar. I think Pastor John mentioned that on Friday. You know, our voice is the shofar. In fact, our voice, or what gives us the ability to produce sound, is very similar to how the trumpet is designed, okay? And so, you know, God also gave us this voice to begin to proclaim. How many of you know? I know you guys are used to things turning on and turning off by your voice activation, but we're talking about something that is not activated by Siri. All right? We're talking about something that is activated by the voice of God that is on the inside of us. This is why it's so important to get our hearts circumcised unto the Lord, so that the covenant and the word of God will flow from our hearts through our mouths as we proclaim. See, this time is about aligning ourselves with God's purposes, because we got away. We got away from some of the things. We stopped coming to church, or we started coming to church, you know, on certain times, or for whatever reason, we begin to make excuses as to why we did not do the things that we know we should have done. This time reminds us, get yourself back straight. Get back in church. Align yourself back with God's purpose. Stop doing all of that other stuff that's distracting you, pulling you away from what God has for you to do. Get yourself back And this is what the trump does during this time. And so this trump calls us to come out of the world system, to begin to tune ourselves with the word of God and not be conformed to the patterns of the world. See how much we've been indoctrinated with the patterns of the world. And now God begins to teach us his patterns. And sometimes because of what we have been taught, we begin to fight against those things. And this is why this time is so important. We begin to align ourselves. And for those, you know, how many of you have ever gotten a revelation or something, and but then you've been around somebody else that did not have that revelation, and you like, you try to, you know, beat it in them and, you know, force it in them, you know, but they didn't get it, and you only made things worse sometimes. But, you know, so this is a time where some of us have come out, some of us have gotten an understanding, a greater understanding, and some of us haven't gotten there yet. And so this is a time where we also intercede for those that have not gotten to the place of understanding where you've gotten in some of these things. And so the whole goal is so that all of us begin to be aligned as a body of Christ. So this is a time of coming out. This, during this time is where we begin to, the, you know, the things that have caused our ears to be dull of hearing the voice of God, where our ear begins to waken up, to get back in tune with the things of God, the voice of God, that so that his voice is not dead in our lives. This blast is to wake us to awaken us to a higher level of decreeing and proclaiming. See, what happens is we begin to see what God is showing us and what he's saying to us during this time. And as we begin to see, now we have the ability to proclaim what we see God showing us, what he's saying to us, because we have set our heart. See, this is why during Rosh Hashanah, right after it goes into the 10 days of awe, because during this time, it's a time of where I am putting my heart before the Lord, so that anything that is this past year where I've seen where I've gotten myself out of alignment with God, now I get myself back into alignment. So that as we approach Yom Kippur, while these books are open and before these books are closed and God's judgment is set for the year, I understand right now that I'm pouring out my heart to make sure that I'm realigning myself with God's purposes. Am I loving the way that I should love? Am I walking in forgiveness as I should? Am I giving as I should? Am I obeying God in those areas? Am I praying as I should? Am I watching things that I shouldn't watch? Am I listening to things that I shouldn't listen to? Am I faithful as I should be? Am I surrounding myself with people that are going to move me forward into the things of God? Or am I one foot in the church and one foot in the world? These are things to help us to align ourselves back with the purposes in the counsel of God. There's this thing called the Gematria, which deals with biblical numerology. In our alphabet, our English alphabet, we have our ABCs, and then we have the numbers that are separate, completely separate from the alphabet. In the Hebrew, the alphabet and the numbers are the same. They express the same values, okay? And so according to biblical scholars, we are in the biblical year of 5,784. That's where we have just stepped into this Rosh Hashanah, okay? And so when you look at the numbers that are presented there, each of the numbers, the Hebrew numbers, they are, as I mentioned, they have the alphabet value, but they also have a numerical value. Plus, they have a pictogram that also communicates certain things about those letters, all right? And oftentimes, these letters have prophetic dimensions or values to them to help us to understand, even during these times and during other times, things that God has ahead, as well as also helping us to understand things that have occurred and so forth as well. But so 5,784 is the year where we have stepped into right now, all right? And so the number that I want to focus on today, right now, is the four in this, which is Dalet, which means doors or openings, okay? And so during this time, there's an expression that is coming forth, okay? You heard Apostle say last week about time of excitement, okay? And again, this is for us as a church. This is not what he's saying for the world, okay? So it's for those that come into the kingdom. But there are, of course, during this time of Rosh Hashanah up through Yom Kippur, there are doors that are always open, okay? But with this four being at the end of this, there are times of doors opening throughout this year, okay, that God is expressing. All right, so what are these doors that are opening? These are doors that are opening for new opportunities that God has this year, okay? These are doors that are being opened for things that you have little to do with, but it has to do with God's timing and his season, okay? His purpose in the earth during this time. What we are doing now is positioning ourselves to be a part of these open doors. Do you understand? Okay, so this is what we are doing during this time. Okay, so there are doors that God is opening during this time and throughout this year, and there are doors that he is shutting. Okay, so there's a two-way effect that is taking place in this. All right, so there are doors that he's opening on our behalf, that he's opening in the church, and this is why you're going to see exciting things. This is why you're going to be astonished by some of the things that take place. There are going to be some supernatural things that take place, okay? Because there are doors that God is opening during this time and during this season, all right? And there are also doors that are being closed, okay? Things that the enemy has had access to, okay? Things that he has robbed from you, okay? Where there's, you know, there have been blessings that have been poured in on one side, but guess what? There's been this gaping hole on the other side that as soon as it comes in, guess what? It's going out the other way, all right? So there are doors that are open right now, okay, that God is expressing and wanting us to know during this time and during this season. So remember the number four, Dalet, okay, represents doors. And so there's an example of the number four that is mentioned in the Bible, and we are very well acquainted with this account in Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. For the sake of time, I'm going to read verses 24 through 26. I want you to see who's at this door. I want you to see who's opening this door. The same one that was proclaiming through Apostle Rock last week. I want you to know who's at this door, who's opening this door on your behalf. It says this, verse 24, it says, then Nebuchadnezzar, the king, was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said unto the king, true, O king. Yeah, this was a very bad situation, king. This was the hottest of hottest fires, O king. This was the worst situation that they could have been thrown into. And he answered and said, lo, I see how many?
Four.
Four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt. And the form of the who? The form of the who? The fourth. So we're going to see things. We're going to see things that you're going to know that the Son of God was right there. This is talking about Jesus right there. See, he's all over the New Testament, of course, but he was all over the Old Testament as well. All right? It says, the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. And then Nebuchadnezzar came near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace, and he spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. And they came forth from of the midst of the fire. So we see here, fourth, open doors, supernatural doors. When it seems like it's at its worst, in the world you will have tribulation. Be of good cheer. I am the door. I am the door. This is what he's saying. Be of good cheer. I am the door. Walk in. Psalm 24. Let's turn over to this. This is the last scripture we'll read today. Everybody say four. Psalm 24, verse 7, it says, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. See, this is a time where we align ourselves with God's purposes. It says, who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. El Gibber. The Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Even lift them up, ye everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Let's acknowledge the kingship, the lordship of Jesus. He is the door that we walk through. He is the door that is open to us. He is the supernatural door that when the furnace gets turned up seven times hotter, all the pressure is on to not bow down to the world, to not succumb to the patterns and the ways and the fears of the Lord, of the world. That if you don't do this, then this is what's going to happen. The Bible says those that know their God shall be strong and do and do and do. Amen. Let's stand all over the house. Pastor John, can you prepare the shofar? Shofar blasting. So we've been talking about the importance of this high holy day, Rosh Hashanah. As Pastor John is preparing the sound of the shofar, allow this sound to resonate in your ears and in your heart. That the blast of this shofar will cause you to remember the Lord and to align yourself with his purposes. that trumpet calling us one day. Father, we bless you today. We thank you for the sounding of the trumpet that has resonated with all our hearts that are here in this place, those that are viewing you from all over the world. Thank you for working on our hearts, convicting our hearts, that even as we heard the sound of the trumpet, Father, we heard your voice speaking to us, drawing us nearer to yourself. Thank you, Father, today for your mercy, your patience, for helping us to know and to understand this appointed time, that we will even search our hearts over the next several days, Father. That if there is any area where we are not aligned with you, that we will passionately, soberly, Father, render ourselves unto you. That Jesus is Lord in every area of our lives. Whether it's any sin, any pattern, any iniquitous pattern, thank you, Father, for the blood of Jesus. That is the antidote. That is the antibiotic for every sin sickness that has been in our lives. Thank you, Father, for opening our hearts even as your books are open. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, those of you that have been viewing us today by live stream, God bless you. Thank you for tuning in and for being a part of this wonderful service as we honor the Lord during this time. You know, he is King. He's King of Kings. And one day all of us are going to stand before him. And as you heard me say earlier, all of the books are going to be open. And I pray that you are at the Bema seat of judgment and not at the great white throne. For there are two judgments that will take place. One for those that are in the body, and one for those that are outside of the body. And I want you to make sure, especially during this time, where God is calling the nations of the earth to himself, as he will even do throughout the millennial reign. I pray that you have and that you make Jesus the Lord of your life. If you have not done so, even if you're in this house today, you've not made Jesus the Lord of your life. As you heard the blast of the shofar, as the Holy Spirit has been convicting you, he's been dealing with your heart. I want to pray with you right now so that you can invite the Lord Jesus in. Say these words with me. Say, "Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you today in the name of Jesus, Yeshua. I believe that Jesus died for me. I believe that he also was raised from the dead after 3 days. I acknowledge and I confess Jesus as my Lord and as my Savior. Even as the books are open, my heart is open unto you, Lord. Come in. Be my Lord and be my Savior. That from this day forward, I am your child. I thank you for saving me now. I ask you to forgive me of every sin that I've ever committed against you. Wash me clean in the blood of Jesus. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen." Amen, amen. Well, if you're out there or in here and you prayed that prayer, please let us know. If you're watching us through our website, send us an email and let us know so that we may continue to encourage you in this walk of the Lord in these days. We would love to hear from you and how God has blessed your life and how he has touched you, through the word today, through the time today, or through anything else that has come forth through this house. We would love to hear from you and encourage you so that wherever it is you are, that there can be a moving forward of the presence and the word of God in your community. So God bless you. Please tune in. Check us out on Daily Bread as it comes forth Monday through Friday, 6 a.m. Eastern Time approximately. On behalf of our apostles, Chastine and Ella Rock, I'm Pastor Milton. We are FCCWO Church. God bless you. See you next time. Shana Tova.